It's Sunday night, and we're talking about, we started off some, maybe a couple of years ago, talking about Hebrews and Revelation. They're both Jewish books. They're both saying a lot of the same thing, and people would say, how in the world do you come up with that? Well, in the first chapter of Revelation, you got the seven candlesticks. I wonder where that came from. How about the book of Exodus over there in the 25th chapter of Exodus, where the Lord is commanding Moses to make these various furniture for the temple, for the tabernacle. And then in Revelation, the fourth chapter, and Christ is standing amidst the candlesticks, and Christ has got seven stars in his right hand. In the first chapter, there in Revelation 1 and verse 16. Then he turns around and says, let me tell you what these seven candlesticks are, and let me tell you what these seven stars are. And he says in verse 20, I've said this a thousand times, verse 20 is a glossary for the whole book. You can look at it and it'll show you this all through the book. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are, how's that? Huh? And people say, I wonder what that is. Well, the seven stars are. How about the seven stars? I'm always giving people a hard time. Seven stars. And always instead of are, I just put equals. The seven stars equals. And he says, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. Seven stars equals seven angels. It doesn't mean heavenly creatures. It can be. It's merely a simple Greek word, angelos, two G's is pronounced NG, angelos, and it means messenger. And every preacher, every pastor of a church was called an angel. So these are the seven messengers. An angel can be Gabriel, or it can be Michael, or it can be one of these heavenly creatures, but it's merely a messenger. If you send a message next door to a lady next door and say, I want to borrow some sugar and one of your kids, they're an angel, not because they're cute, simply because they're a messenger. That's what they're doing. So, and then he says, the seven candlesticks are the seven churches. And this is the way I like to put it. Seven candlesticks are equals seven churches. And when you go into Revelation 2 and 3, the third chapter, you have the seven churches. Well, each one of the church has a glitch, or they have what you and I would call a sin that besets them. So in order to be a seven church, seven is the word Sheba in the Hebrew. It comes from the word Shabua, S-H-E-B-U-A-H. Shabua means to take an oath to God. Well, you cannot take an oath until you fix these sins in the churches. Now, when I went through Revelation, I went through each one of these churches. I didn't finish the last church of Galatia, but I'll go back and finish that this time around. But to take an oath means you have to be living righteously to God. So God has to do something to get this sin out of the churches. And this word Shabua means, it means to take an oath, or 2-7 oneself. Let me tell you the easiest way how you become sevened. Let me make it this way. Sevened. How you become seven, you do what Peter said, 2 Peter 1 and 5. Here's how, Well, look at that over in 2 Peter. Look at that. 2 Peter 1 and verse 5. Here's how you're become sevened. Okay, let me get a word of 2 Peter. 2 Peter 1, verse 5. Besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith. Faith has to grow. And when he says add to your faith, he's not inviting you to add. He's commanding you to be sevened because he names seven things here. Besides all this, give all diligence, add. The word add, epikoregeo, E-P-I-C-H-O-R-E-G-E-O. Epikoregeo, it looks a lot different than add. Well, it is. It's an imperative command. God's not inviting us to add to our faith. He's not inviting for our faith to grow. You'll quit complaining about life. You'll quit complaining about anything when you get older and you become sevened. I don't complain about anything anymore. I get miserable. I get to feeling bad. I look at the world. I don't like it. I don't like it because they don't believe God, but I know it's the way it's supposed to be, so I accept it, and I don't get frustrated over it. I just say, oh, it is supposed to be. They don't believe the truth about predestination. They don't believe the truth. But God has put me through right at 78 years of trial and fire, and now I know I can accept these things because God has added this to my faith. He didn't ask me if I would like to add. He commands me to add to your faith. And this is being sevened. So these churches have to be sevened in Revelation. And when we get to that second and third chapter, we'll see their problem. God says, if you're not sevened, he says to the church at Ephesus, in the second chapter of Revelation, look here. When I think of the seven churches, here's what I think of right here. I think of the candlesticks, the golden candlesticks. Notice it's the Star of David, and you look at it from the top. I believe that's exactly what it is. Don't have time to go into that. And each one of these sticks here, these candlesticks, each one of them has a flame coming out of it. The flame is due to oil that's inside the candlesticks, and that would be a picture of the angels or the message, and what's inside the candlestick is the oil, and that's a picture of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is truth. Even the rabbis said that the candlesticks preached the truth of God. And that's where the light comes from. Light is equated with truth. So when I think of the seven churches, I think of a golden candlestick with oil in it, with the truth in it. And you're the candlestick, and the oil is the Holy Spirit in you. Just look at Ephesus. I brought this out. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. But look at verse 1 of chapter 2. When you look at the Ephesians, they had a lot of problems. In fact, Timothy was pastor of the church at Ephesus. Ephesus is over here on the western end of Turkey. It's a Gentile church. Well, this is not working. I'm not working here, Mike. Well, I'll have to do without it, won't I? Or is it broke?
I think I see a problem there.
Huh?
I think I see part of the problem.
You do? All right.
I want to kill this guy.
Anyway, Ephesus had a lot of problems. Let's just read it here. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, and the seven stars are the angels. Let me put it this way. The seven stars is the oil in the candlesticks that gives us the light. And we're the candlesticks when we are perfected. I'll have to go back to Peter. It's working now? All right. All right. Ephesus is over here. This is Turkey right here. Here's Jerusalem over here. This is Israel. Well, Ephesus is right here. That's on far west of Turkey as you can get. That was called Asia Minor back in that day and time. Now, here was the problem that Ephesus had. These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. If you back up, you see that in verse 16 of chapter 1. And he says, who walketh in the midst of the seven candlesticks, or who walks in the middle of the seven churches, or the refined church, and he intends to refine the church. I know thy works, Ephesus. Ephesus had some false teachers there. They had a man named Hymenaeus, a man named Philetus, a man named Alexander. Alexander stood against Paul in Acts the 19th chapter when he was over at Ephesus. When Paul came to Ephesus, Ephesus was a place where they manufactured, it was the home of the goddess Diana. And they made these idols to Diana and sold them in their marketplaces. And they accused Paul of trying to stop them from making their idols. And Alexander, one of the young preachers at the church in Ephesus, stood with them against Paul. And Paul warns Timothy, he says, be thou ware of Alexander. He will hurt you. You mean a young preacher in the church will hurt the church? Oh, yes. Yes, sir. And then he said, Hymenaeus and Philetus are two young preachers there at Ephesus, Timothy, and they have shipwrecked the faith. He said, they have said that the resurrection is past. Now, that word resurrection there in 2 Timothy is the word anastasis. Anastasis is feminine gender. It's not talking about the resurrection of Christ. It can't be. It's talking about the resurrection of the church daily as we die daily. Resurrection means to come to life after dying. And they said all you have to do is die one time when you believe God or accept Christ or whatever you want to call it. All you have to do is resurrect one time and it's good for life. No, it's not, because we have to die daily and resurrect daily. How do you describe that, Jim? Well, going out here and witness to one person, and you die when they cut off fellowship with you. As soon as you start saying something to somebody that upsets them or bothers them, and they don't know enough about it to even argue with you about it, they just back away from you and they cut off from you, and next time they see you, they don't want to talk to you. Oh, hi there, Jim. Good to see you, and I got to run. It's because you have said some things that bothers them, and death means separation. It doesn't mean to be annihilated. So that's what happens. And they had Hymenaeus and Philetus. They had a man named Phygellus, one named Hermogenes, and they were causing Timothy all kinds of problems over there. So you're going to find that's true when Paul is talking about Ephesus. I know thy works, thy labor, and thy patience, how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them to be liars. You've done this much, and hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, however, you got a problem, Ephesus. I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first agape, love. Agape is walking in the commandments of God, 2 John 6, agape. This is love, this is agape, that we walk after His commandments. You have stopped walking in the commandments of God. He tells that to Ephesus. Then he says, remember therefore from whence you art fallen. Remember how you were when you used to walk in the commandments. You got all these false teachers over there saying things. He says, and repent and do the first works you used to do. This has got to be straightened out before you can be sevened. For else, or else I will come unto thee and quickly and remove thy candlestick. I'll pull your light out. Well, it doesn't take long for you to drain the oil in that part of the candlestick, and you're no longer preaching truth. And that's what he's talking about here. So each one of these churches has a problem. Back over to 2 Peter. If you're going to be sevened, here's what you have to do. I didn't mean to get this far in it, into this, but I'll keep on going here one day. 2 Peter 1 and 5. I love this chapter because I love these things you have to add to your faith. Give all diligence, add, that's a command, to your faith, virtue, arete. That means maturity. Now, how long is it going to take you to add maturity to your life? A long time. 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. You're not going to get there quick. It takes a long time, a lot of tears, a lot of hurting, a lot of crying. It takes a lot of weariness to come to the place of saying, well, it looks like this is going to be with me the rest of my life, so I'll just buckle down and live for the Lord. Virtue, you have to add virtue. Arete, A-R-E-T-E. It means to grow up. Become mature. Has the basic same meaning as teleos. Perfect. Be therefore perfect. Grow up and be mature. It's a synonym for teleos. Then he says, add these things. Add virtue to virtue knowledge. Now, you know how long it takes to add a lot of knowledge to your... You can't just wander around as a Christian saying, I believe in predestination. I believe Christmas is pagan, Easter is pagan. I believe that God doesn't love everybody. Now, that's all I really need to know. No, it's not. You need to hear these. I've been accused of repeating myself. I'll repeat these words the rest of my life. I hope that you wake up in your sleep saying them. Because when you do, if I can say them a thousand times to you, you'll say, I've heard that before. Good. At least you recognize you heard it before. Some people who don't hear enough don't even recognize when they've heard it before. Knowledge. I have spent 60 years of my life studying. Had some bad years, and the bad years were no good. The bad years, all it did was let me know I had to get back with Christ. Now you say, well, Jim, I have such a hard time reading the Bible. So did I when I was young. I'd read, and I'd force myself to read, and I'd get bored, and I don't know how I can keep reading. I don't have time to read. I'm busy doing this and this and this. And the more I learned to read, the more I learn, the more I understand. Then he says, from not to knowledge, you have to add temperance. Boy, that is the hardest thing in the world to learn. Enkratia, E-J-K-R-E-T-E-I-A. E-G-K-R-E-T-E-I-A. Comes from kratos, meaning strength within. Strength within. You mean drinking? Well, yeah, that, but that's not all there is to temperance. Losing your temper, getting angry, not being able to think rationally. When you get upset because somebody did you wrong, somebody cut you off in traffic, somebody cheated you out of some money. You know what I've learned? Anybody that cheats me out of money, I'm not going to get it back. Did you know that? You're not going to get it back. You think you are? You're not. Why don't you just forget it and go your way? Okay? I've learned to do that. But I've also learned to stay away from those kind of people. I have to watch out for them. I don't go back in and say, well, I forgive you. Let's get back to what we're doing. No. Stay away from them. It's every kind of temperance. It's strength. It would be drinking or strength or being loose with your moral strength. It would be strength to be able to study. When I was young, I had to force myself to study, and I couldn't always force myself. Does anybody have that problem? I still have that problem. But I keep these things that I learn in my mind, and it makes me want to go to my library and pull a book out and find out what that means. Now, then he says, to knowledge, temperance, to temperance, patience. Hupomone. Boy, this is going to take you a long time to learn this. Because the trying of your faith worketh patience. Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing that the trying of your faith works patience, and let this patience have its perfect work. Don't sit around saying, I want my trials to go away. If they're more, if the trying of your faith is more precious than gold that perisheth, would you pray that your bank will go bankrupt? It's like having gold in the bank after you go through so many trials in life. It's like having gold. You know how to deal with it. Usually you don't deal with it. You just walk away, get away from the people that's cheating and lying, and leave them alone and keep them out of your life. And you even learn what kind of person does that. Very unstable people, people that are sowing all kinds of discord, people that are building you up and giving you a bunch of good words and fair speeches that makes you feel good. Well, you have to learn what those... Let me tell you something. Maybe you already know this. Most young people don't. Anytime you hear real flashy words that makes you feel real good, run. Get away from those people. I've got something for you. God has a way for you, and put their hand on his shoulder. I can just see God in your life. Get that man, get your hand off of me. It's a con. Every time. Go buy a car and watch him. Boy, Mr. Brown, you're a great guy. You don't know me. What do you mean I'm a great guy? You like my car? It's 17 years old. It's not a classic. It's old. And they're going to say these things to you, selling you houses, cars, or anything else. When people want to get your attention, they're trying to sell you something if it's juicy and flowing with milk and honey, and you just think, this is wonderful. Don't ever believe that. When your people trying to sell a bill of goods, that doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. Leave them alone. You got a hard time in life. You're going through trials in life. That's going to be here. Don't listen to a bunch of good words and syrupy speeches. Now, let's finish this. Patience. To patience, godliness. Boy, there's been a lot about this. Eusebia. It actually means to be like God, godly, a well-sebomai. Sebomai has the idea, one of the writers said, as the gospel scheme of things, the gospel scheme. The gospel is the resurrection, according to 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. So if the gospel is a resurrection, you have to be dying daily to self to be godly. That takes a long time to learn how to do that. I've learned fighting. You have to learn to quit fighting. Let me add a word to that. Ever. That's hard to learn. Don't ever fight as a believer. Can you do that when you're 30 and 35? Nope. You're going to have to get somewhere down the road. When you get down the road, you say, what you'll do, you wake up one day and say, all that fighting I've been doing, it just hasn't been working. I guess I need to try something else, don't I? Yeah, not fight. And the fight doesn't start with your mouth. It doesn't start with your fist. It starts in your mind, with your imagination, that they're trying to do something to you. And they may be. But if they are, just get away from them. and to godliness, brotherly kindness. Philosadelphos. Philadelphos. Philos, it is a construction of philos and adelphos. Adelphos is the word brother. Is the word brother, and philos is affection. This has to do with affection for your brothers, but if you like them, it's going to be because they're trying to walk in the commandments of God. Jesus said to us, you are my brothers if you do the things I say. Now, if we're predestined to be like Christ, we're only brothers to people who are trying to walk in the commandments of God. I didn't say trying to completely walk in them. If they're really trying and making an effort to live godly and righteously, you have to learn to forbear their shortcomings, their idiosyncrasies. Forbear, aneko, or anekomai. That's the word forbear there in Ephesians, the first chapter. Forbear, it means to put up, ana, to hold up, echo, or to put up with their peculiarities and peculiar ways. We have to learn that about one another. Now, do you know that that is my main responsibility here, is to learn everybody's personality and to find out what they're like, and how and what offends them and what don't offend them. And I need to learn how to talk to everybody different. Well, so do you if you're going to be the believer you're supposed to be. And then he says, this amazes me. He says, to godliness, to brotherly kindness, add charity. Add agape, agape. Agape. Now, don't you notice something here? I didn't see this here a few weeks ago. We started off with adding to faith, didn't we? Isn't that what we started with? Add to faith. Add to faith. And the final thing on the list is agape, walking in the commandments of God. And remember, we talked about Galatians 5:14, faith worketh by agape, by love. Remember that? We taught on that for several weeks. Faith works. And the working part could be these middle six things right before agape and right after faith. So we have to, the way we grow up and mature, you ought to just go in here and memorize these things and study them just intently, because this is what we have to do to become mature believers. Now, and we were talking about that, about the churches in Asia, the seven churches. Now I want us to go back over there. I started off by talking about how that Revelation was a Jewish book. You got Jesus amidst the candlesticks. Then you got the seven churches, and we need to see what's wrong with them. And then when you get over there to chapter 4, we see the picture of the temple. And he talks about, in chapter 4, verse 1, after this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. When you see something like that, just heaven, you and I don't know what that means if you don't look it up. Now, the heavens that we know of is the heavens is where God is. We don't know what that is. Where God is. And then you have the heavens above us. Heavens above us. And that would be the atmosphere above us. That would be the atmosphere, the sky, the stratosphere. That's the heavens to us. And then you have the heavens. The heavens. That is the ruling class. The ruling class. When you go into McClintock and Strong, you pull out the H volume. Let me see here if I got it available. Pull out the H volume and look up heavens, and the first thing it will say has nothing to do with the heavens over our head. It doesn't have anything to do with where God dwells. Heaven. Let me just read this to you. H-E-A-V-E-N. You see, I know what it says. I've read it so many times. T-U-V. Heaven. Heaven. Threefold world. The invisible, the visible, and the political among men. The political area of the world. Which last may be either civil or ecclesiastical, terrestrially and figurative regarded. Wherever the scene of prophetic vision is laid, heaven signifies symbolically the ruling power or government. In fact, if you look up Mount in the M volume, it will tell you, when you look at Mount, they will tell you just under M-O-U-N-T. They'll tell you that a mount was a capital city of an empire. And that horns meant a ruling class. And then you have the horns, have the capital city, and anything that rules would be horns. In fact, when you look at the last verses of Zechariah, the first chapter, it will say these horns are the four that carried Israel away into captivity. And what would that be? Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome. They were called horns. And these are all one and the same thing. There was one other there. I can't remember what it was. The capital city is a mount. Horns is also means power or ruling class. So anytime you're seeing something, that's what these books are so good for. You can find out what they actually mean. And it will tell you at the end of this heavens, it will say heaven and earth. And you have to apply this whenever you're reading the Bible. When the Bible says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven, they would shorten that and say, call it heavens. The kingdom of heaven was a term for Israel. Kingdom of God was a term for Israel. But the rabbis wanted the word God dropped. They didn't want to bring anything upon this holy name of God, and they would write God G-D. And about 200 B.C., the rabbis said, let's drop the word God and put heavens, kingdom of heaven, instead of kingdom of God. Well, that was a term for Israel because God was their king. Now, when you get into this heaven and earth, listen to this. You've heard this all your life. Heaven and earth is an expression for the whole creation. In prophetic language, the phrase often signifies the political state or the condition of persons of different ranks in the world. The heaven of the political world is the sovereignty, whoever rules. That's why the kingdom of heaven is ours when we believe God. But listen to what he says. thereof, whose host and stars are the powers that rule, namely kings, princes, counselors, magistrates. That's the heavens. The earth is the peasantry, the plebeians, the lower class, or common race of men who possess no power but are ruled by superiors. If ours is the kingdom of heaven, and the Bible says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. The meek is us. Meek is the word praus, P-R-A-U-S. It means tame. How long does God have to work on each one of us to tame us, to seven us? Takes a long time, doesn't it? Long, long time for us to get over our tempers. And I used to have one of the worst. Of such is the heaven and earth. So if blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. When God calms you down, rides you into the ground, makes you tame, you will control the earth. And we don't mean they'll make you mayor or governor or president. We're talking about out of our mouths will come the word of God with all of this virtue and this knowledge, all this tenderness and gentleness, and you'll rule men with that. People don't like for you to come up and say something that's against their beliefs. And they don't have any answers, and you've worked and have all this knowledge and this maturity, and you speak these truths, and it cuts into them. They want to get away from you. You say, well, look, I've learned something about Christmas. I've found out it's paganism. And they don't want to hear that, and they'll move away from you and get away. When they don't want to hear what you're saying, they'll look off in a distance. I've had people do that. I've been talking to them, and they'll go. That means I don't want to hear what you're saying. And you're actually ruling them with a scepter of righteousness, Hebrews 1 and 8. Scepter, rabdos, that's a ruling rod. The word righteousness there is euthetos, E-U-T-H-E-T-O-S. Euthetos comes from the word eu and tithemai. Well, eu means well, tithemai means leveling. When you level to the will of God, and you're leveling to His book and His righteousness, that's the rod that we rule people with. I've told the story many times. One of the best examples of that I know of. I was still in real estate in the early 90s, and I went into an office to pick up a key to show a house. And I went in there, and this guy I used to work with is an old retired Marine sergeant. And he came out, and they had several plastic women sitting on this bench over here waiting to go jump in their Cadillacs and show their guys, show their people, their clientele. And this fellow come out loud and boisterous and said, I feel good today. I feel great today. And he's trying to make noise for these ladies over here. And I said, well, you must have Jesus in your heart. And he let loose with cursing. Now, blankety blank. I said, well, I can tell you don't have Jesus in your heart by what's coming out of your mouth, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Boy, he didn't think he's going to get that in front of these good-looking ladies. He said, I got to go. That's the way you rule people. That's a scepter of righteousness. But you got to be able to back it up. Learn these words. Learn the Greek. Learn the scriptures. Learn the text so that when you run into somebody, they won't give you a hard time. I've had people do that to me. I had one real estate agent used to get in front of me and cuss. And he knew I was the preacher. He knew all that. But he knows, you do that in front of me, I'm going to get you. I'll get you right here. And one day I saw him at Ace Hardware, and he said, Jim, I listened to you on radio on Saturday morning. How in the hell do you learn all those things? I said, well, I don't learn them in hell, Bill. I'll tell you what I do. I go home and I study all the time. I've done this for years, and he's just going. I just answered him back, I don't learn them in hell. And he didn't know what to do with that kind of answer. So I promised myself, if he does that when I'm alone with him, I'll get him when he get up to the counter up here. So we got up to the counter. There's a bunch of people around in the cashier, and I start talking about Jesus and God and salvation and predestination. He's going, wanting to crawl out. Why do you think you're going to get by with that with me? You're not. Because I knew him real well. I knew he was a loudmouth and a know-it-all. And I just thought, well, I'll just nail him to the floor right here. Now, I don't treat everybody that way. Let me read the rest of this. This will help you understand how we inherit the earth. The earth is the peasantry, plebeians, common race of men, who possess no power but are ruled by superiors. And that would be us in this case. Of such a heaven and earth, we may understand mentioned to be made in Haggai 2 and 6. There's not six chapters in there. Another one of the books, I guess. Such modes of speaking were used in the Oriental poetry and philosophy, which made a heaven and an earth in everything. That is, a superior and an inferior. In God's kingdom, we are the superior people. We have the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And we learned from Maimonides, quoted by me, that the Arabians in his time, when they would express that a man was fallen into some great calamity, said, his heavens are fallen to the earth, meaning his superiority or prosperity is much diminished. To look for new heavens and new earth may mean to look for a new order of the present world. Now, I want to take you somewhere with that. Go over to Revelation. I can't give you everything I want to give you on something. Go to Revelation, the 21st chapter. New heavens and new earth. I want to take you somewhere with this. Now, we're talking about being sevened, growing up and being mature and being able to wield the sword of the Spirit. Look here, I don't believe what most people believe. I said this is a Jewish book. You're going to see the Jewishness of the church in the 21st chapter. Verse 1, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. This is John talking. This is not the first time this is mentioned. Go back to Isaiah, the 65th chapter. Isaiah 65. And along the way, I want to try to help you see some of the error that's been propagated in the name of truth. All right, Isaiah 65. This is where this is beginning to come forth. Isaiah 65. Now, all through the book of Isaiah, Isaiah is saying, Isaiah is like an Old Testament Paul. Paul is like a New Testament Isaiah. Let me show you that real quick. Then I'll get into this new heaven and new earth. All right, when you look through Isaiah's writings, I'll just give you a couple of them. In Isaiah, the 42nd chapter, Isaiah prophesies to Israel all through this that God's going to reject you and carry you away captive. And God has a people upon the earth, and it's called the Gentiles. And I told you that if you obeyed me, you've got a kingdom. Everything that you will want and desire, all your needs, all the food. When you come against your enemy, you'll go against them one way. They'll flee seven ways. And all through Isaiah, he constantly talks. God's going to reject Israel. And Isaiah's prophesying in 722 B.C. He'd been prophesying. He prophesied for about 50 years. Remember, Jeremiah prophesied for 40 years. Those people had a lot of warning. about what God was going to do from these two prophets. Now, here in, Isaiah 42. Isaiah calls the Gentiles, he says they were in darkness. Without truth, and they did not have, they were without light. They were not enlightened as to God's truth. The only people who had the truth in the Old Testament was the Jews. Just the Jews on the eastern end of the Mediterranean Sea, just right here. That's all that had the truth, right here. Everybody else was in darkness. For 4,000 years. They were the spirits in prison, prison meaning the division of day and light or light and darkness. And not until Acts, the second chapter, when God sends Peter to preach to the Jews from every nation under heaven, and they're going to take this truth back to their Gentile world and preach it to them. God opens the eyes of the Gentiles for the first time in Acts 2. Their eyes have not been opened as a nation. There would be a Gentile here and there. Nebuchadnezzar, God opened his eyes. God opened the eyes of Ruth, a Moabite. God opened the eyes of a few others, Uriah the Hittite. He opened up a few eyes. But on a national scale, the Gentiles didn't get the truth to hear. Acts 2, where God pours out of His Spirit on all flesh, and that means all flesh would be in opposition to the one flesh of the Old Testament, the Jewish flesh, but He blinds their eyes right before He opens the eyes of the Gentiles. Isaiah's entire message is about God bringing the Gentiles to the light. Isaiah is preaching back in the 8th century B.C., 8th century. But Isaiah's message is about the Gentiles under Paul. His job was to preach to the Gentiles. He said so. And when you, I'll read a couple of things here in Isaiah 42, verse 6. I, the Lord, have called thee in righteousness and will hold thine hand and will keep thee and give thee for a covenant of the people, for a light of the Gentiles. He's prophesying about when God blinds the eyes of the Jews and He opens the eyes of the Gentiles. To open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoner from the prison. That's what Peter said. Preach that Christ went to preach to the spirits in prison or the Gentiles upon His resurrection. And then them that sit in darkness out of the prison house. He says this all through this book, all through the book of Isaiah. He says here in chapter 49 or 48, he says, I had a verse here I was going to give you. In 49, he says in verse 6, I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the end of the earth, all over the world. God's salvation will be to the Gentiles. He says in verse 9 of that chapter, that thou mayest say to the prisoners, go forth to them that are in darkness, show yourselves that thou shalt feed in the ways, and their pastures shall be in high places. Now look here in Acts 26. Paul says much the same thing that Isaiah is saying. Okay, over here in, where did I say we were going? Oh, Acts 26. Paul is recounting his experience on the Damascus Road to Agrippa, who was a Herod king, and he's the one that said, Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian in this speech here. And he says to him, Acts 26, And Paul is relating this to Agrippa in the first verse. And Agrippa said unto Paul, Thou art permitted to speak for thyself. Then Paul stretched forth the hand and answered for himself. And he goes into the story of Christ. And he expresses how Christ came to him in verse 14, when we were all fallen to the earth there in Acts 9, I heard a voice speaking unto me, saying in the Hebrew dialect, not the Hebrew language, the Hebrew dialect of the Koine. They had a different dialect of the Koine in every city-state. And the Hebrew dialect where he was, he says it in that Hebrew dialect of the Greek language. Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. The pricks were the ox goad that was behind the oxen, and all they did was hurt themselves when they would kick. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of those things which thou hast seen, and of those things which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send you. I'm sending you to the Gentiles to do these things, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light. And they've been blind and they've been in prison for these 4,000 years. And from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. Forgiveness, aphesis, means to pardon and release from prison. That's what Paul came to the Gentiles for. Isaiah prophesied this would happen, and it's happening with Paul. When you read the second chapter of Galatians, that's a Gentile church. All of Paul's epistles were written to a Gentile church, every one of them. And he would say to each one of them things like, You were darkness, but now are you light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. He would say, You're not the children of the darkness, that they should overtake you as a thief. And I talked about the darkness this morning, didn't I? That's all those pagan festivals. He'd say, You're translated into the kingdom of His dear Son, the kingdom of light, there in Colossians, the first chapter. He would tell all those churches, You were in darkness. And Paul said, I've come to bring you the light. Now, we've taught that Old Testament was literal Israel, and we are spiritual Israel. Old Testament was the kingdom of God. We're the spiritual kingdom of God, or spiritual Israel. Now go back over to Isaiah, the 65th chapter. If you can get this, this will really help you along. Well, he says back in Isaiah, I need to finish a couple of things here. Isaiah 40, well, I already read that. Isaiah 49:22, Thus saith the Lord, I will lift up mine hand to the Gentiles. 42:22, he says in Isaiah 61, the very words that Jesus stood up and quoted in Luke 4:18, in 61:1, The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach the good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to bring liberty to the captives, those that have been in prison, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. He says in verse 9 of chapter 6, And their seed shall be known among the Gentiles. Now, go to 65. This is the chapter where new heavens is brought up, right here. Have you noticed what I'm teaching tonight? I don't know if you've noticed it yet. It's like a mesh coming together like this. And it will come together like that as we teach. I am sought of them, verse 1, chapter 65. I am sought of them that ask not for me. What he's saying, I am sought by the Gentiles. They never asked for me, and I didn't pick them out. And I picked them out from the foundation of the world, but I chose literal Israel to be my children. I am found of them that sought me not. That's the Gentiles. I said, behold me, look at me. Behold me unto a nation that was not called by my name. Gentiles. We weren't called by the name of God. We are in the New Testament, but he's saying the ones that were called by my name was literal Israel. I have spread out my hands all day unto a rebellious people, literal Israel, which walketh in a way that was not good after their own thoughts. Israel, a people that provoked me to anger continually to my face when they went after all those gods, Baal, Grove, Shemash, Molech, and so forth. And they sacrificed in gardens. He is condemning Israel for all their sacrifices to Baal and Grove and so forth. And they burn incense unto altars of brick, which remain among graves and lodge in monuments, and they eat swine's flesh, and I told them not to. And broth of abominable things is in their vessels. And here's what Israel said to me. Stand by thyself. Come not near me, for I am holier than thou. God picked us out, and he loves us best because he chose us there in Deuteronomy 7 and 7, not because we were the largest, we were the smallest. And I'm holier than you because God loves me first. For I am holier than thou. These are smoke in my nose. He said, these Israelites, these priests of God stink. They sting my nose. A fire that burneth all the day. Behold, it is written before me. I will not keep silence, but I will recompense, even recompense into their bosom, your iniquities, Israel, and the iniquities of your fathers, when you came and took the land after you'd been 400 years in Egypt, which have burned incense upon mountains. He's talking about the paganism they were involved in. He's talking about offering their children to Molech in Jeremiah the 19th chapter. He's talking about eating their children in 2 Kings the 6th chapter. And blaspheme me upon the hills. He's talking to Israel. He's not talking to pagans. Do you understand that? Therefore will I measure their former work into their bosom. You cannot take fire in your bosom and not be burnt, and that's what they were doing. Thus saith the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one saith, destroy it not, for a blessing is it, so will I do for my servant's sake, that I may not destroy them all. I won't kill them all. When the Babylonian king came in, he destroyed all of the wealthy, the rich, those who were artificers, those people that worked in metals that could make weapons, and he left the poor there. And Jeremiah said, I'll stay with the poor here. After he was given the opportunity to go to Babylon and be free and be a landowner. That I may destroy them all, I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob. Jacob is Israel. Remember that? And out of Judah, an inheritor of my mountains. What does he mean, an inheritor of my mountains? Well, who will inherit the mountain of God there in Psalms, the 15th chapter? Look at the mountain of God. Mountains of God was Zion and Moriah. Zion was just another name. It means sunny. Zion was a name for the mountains there where Jerusalem sat, and Moriah was where, that's where Mount Moriah, who was where Abraham in that 22nd chapter of Genesis took his son over there to kill him. Because God said, take thy son, thine only son Isaac, 24th chapter. Take thine only son Isaac and offer him for an offering upon Mount Moriah. That is where the temple was constructed in many years later, about 2,100 years later. And Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the valley of Achor a place for herds to lie down in for my people that have sought me. But ye Israel, here's who you are. I'm still talking about new heavens. But ye Israel, remember the heavens was the ruling class. Who was ruling in the ancient world when they were behaving, following the commandments of God? Israel. God says, you'll go against your enemy one way when you're obedient to me, and they will flee seven ways. Nobody can stand against you. One man, Samson, took the jawbone of an ass and killed 1,000 men at one time. You can't do that unless something super powerful comes over you. 7,000 Israelites in that 21st chapter of 1 Kings went against, 2 Kings, went against nearly 127,000. 7,000 Israelites. And they went out there against the Syrians. And the Bible says the Syrians covered the plain and Israel went up against them like two little flocks of kids, of goats. And Israel goes against them and Israel slaughters them with 7,000 fighting men. That's not possible. You see, you will be the ruler of the earth when you follow after God's commandments. That is true for us. I kept trying to be a ruler in the world and make lots of money and become powerful, and God will not let His children do that. All you have to do is bow to His will, and it might take 30 years before He makes you a ruler in this earth and you inherit the earth. That's after you become sevened. But ye are they that forsake the Lord, that forget by holy mountain, the holy mountain of God was Zion. Actually, in the second chapter of Zechariah, is around 520 B.C., Zechariah is prophesying. He prophesies for 2 years, and Israel's been carried into captivity in 586 B.C., and these decrees have been given for Israel to go back and rebuild the temple. And Zechariah says, deliver thyself, O Zion, from the daughter of Babylon. He said, come out of Babylon. They've given you decrees. There's no reason for you to stay there. But Israel was a wasteland. Why do they want to go back? They're free in Babylon now, making lots of money. They don't want to go back. And he calls all the people in Babylon that are Israelites, he calls them Zion. So when you see the holy mountain of God, aren't we Mount Zion, heavenly Jerusalem? Isn't that what we are? Hebrews 12, 22. We come to Mount Zion, heavenly Jerusalem, the church. Mount Zion is the church now. And we're heavenly Jerusalem, aren't we? And that's God's heavenly city. That is God's mount. And we rule with a rod of iron. We rule with the rod of righteousness, bowing to the will of God. That's the only way your life will straighten out. That's the only way you become sevened. Now, look here. Back up to Psalms 15. Let me show you something. You can't preach one part of the Bible without preaching the other parts. Psalms 15. Look what he says here in Psalms 15. This will tell you about the mountain of God. 15th Psalm. All right. Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? God's holy hill is Zion. That's where the tabernacle, that's where the temple sits. Now he's going to give you an answer. Who's going to inherit God's holy mountain? Right here. He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor. Anytime you see God's holy mountain, these are the things you have to be. You have to be sevened. In whose eyes a vile person is contemned. There's has nothing but contempt for you. But he honoreth them that fear the Lord, he that sweareth to his own hurt and will not change. I'll swear and tell you the truth, and I will not change the truth just because you don't like it. That's who's going to inherit God's holy mountain. He that putteth not out his money to excessive interest rates, greedy, nor taketh reward against the innocent, he that doeth these things shall never be moved. You want to be these things? Then work on 2 Peter 1 and 5. Besides all this, give all diligence. Just add to your faith. Now go back over here to Isaiah 65. He says, you pour out, but ye are they, verse 11, that forsake the Lord. He's talking to Israel. All through this, he's talking about the Gentiles coming to the light. Gentiles coming out of prison. That forget my holy mountain, that prepare a table for that troop. Troop is the word menai, M-E-N-I-Y. It means number. The number in the ancient world was the moon. It numbered the seasons there in Genesis, the first chapter. You pour out drink offerings to the moon. By the way, another name for Allah is Mene. Said Israel was worshiping Allah long before, 600 years before, or actually about 1,000 years before Islam even began. What's amazing to me, when you look at the tree goddess of Isaiah 44, the tree goddess, or the oak, is the word Alan, comes from the word Allah. What happened around 536 AD under Mohammed? Mohammed was the Constantine. When Constantine amalgamated all of those church, all of those paganism into the church at Rome, what Mohammed did, he amalgamated all these tree goddesses and gods into Islam. But that was in the 6th century AD. I had an acquaintance that was going out here to Vanderbilt. Years ago, he said he was talking to an Arab out there, and the Arab told him, he said the same thing you're saying from the pulpit. I said, what's that? He said that Islam goes all the way back to the ancient world, and that was all those gods and goddesses they worshiped back there. It's the same thing as Christ's Mass. Now, let's keep reading. How much time do I have, Mike? 24. I'm not getting to as far as I want to get. So he's talking about, he says, and they pour out drink offerings to that number. Excuse me, that's the word numbers, mene. Troop is the word gad. Some say we get the word God from gad. Pour drink offerings to that number, and he's talking, he's condemning Israel. Therefore will I number you to the sword, Israel, and ye shall bow down to the slaughter when the Assyrian kings come in. Isaiah is prophesying against northern Israel, and it's the Assyrians that come in and carry him away with the sword. Because when I called, you did not answer. When I spake, you did not hear, but did evil before mine eyes, and did choose that wherein I delighted not, going after all these gods, these sun and tree gods. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, my servants shall eat, but you shall be hungry, Israel. What does he mean, my servants? Those that follow me. Behold, my servants shall drink, but you shall be thirsty. Behold, my servants shall rejoice, but ye shall be ashamed, Israel. Behold, my servants shall sing for joy of heart, but ye shall cry for sorrow of heart, and shall howl for vexation of spirit, and ye shall leave your name for a curse unto my chosen people. He's talking about the Gentile church here. Unto my chosen, for the Lord God shall slay you and call his servants by another name, Gentile Israel, New Testament. He prophesies all through this book about the Gentiles coming to the light. Then he who blesseth himself in the earth shall bless himself in the God of truth, and he that sweareth in the earth shall swear by the God of truth, but cause the former troubles are forgotten. Israel will be forgotten. They'll be blinded because they are hid from mine eyes. For behold, I create a new ruling class, a new heavens and new earth. That's not talking about the little creation of a literal heaven and a little earth. That's talking about the Gentiles who are going to rule with the scepter of righteousness. I create a new ruling class. I told you, Israel, if you're obedient to my laws, you could go against any enemy and you can conquer them. When you become seasoned in the Lord and become mature in truth, and you learn the Word of God, you can go against your enemy and they will run away from you. Some of you have told me recently, I've been talking to somebody and they would just turn away and look up in the air and want to pull away because they didn't want to hear what you were saying. That's what rules people, is knowing the truth of the Word of God. I'll create new heavens and new earth, and the former shall not be remembered. That's literal Israel, won't be remembered anymore, nor come into mind, but ye, and be ye glad and rejoice forever in that I create, for behold, I create Jerusalem a rejoicing and her people a joy. Hey, let's go over here to Hebrews. The new Jerusalem is us, the church. Go over here to Hebrews. And this is the Zion he's talking about. And this is the Jerusalem he's talking about. It's a spiritual Jerusalem. It's the church. And if you miss this, you get all kinds of screwy ideas about those verses. Oh, that's the thousand-year reign. It is not. That's the church. We're the new heavens and the new earth. The new earth is here. Israel was called the heavens when they were obedient to God, and when they became disobedient, he says, I'm taking you off of that perch, and you're no longer the ruling class. I'm not going to let you beat all your enemies when you're against insurmountable odds. Not anymore. Look over here in Hebrews. Hebrews is a Jewish book. All right. All right, Hebrews 12, verse 22. He speaks of the mountain that might not be touched, which was Mount Sinai in verse 18. And if an animal came and touched the mountain, they had to be thrust through with a dart or a spear. And then he says, but ye are come unto Mount Zion. When the Bible speaks of Zion in the Old Testament, we're Mount Zion. Zion is where the temple was. Are we not the temple of the Holy Spirit? Which temple ye are? He says, but ye are coming to Mount Zion, unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. So, spiritual Zion is heavenly Jerusalem, the church, isn't it? The reason these guys can't understand this, they go along with dispensationalism, or they go along with a pre-trib rapture, and they split up the continuity of the scriptures. You cannot split the Old Testament from the New. The Old Testament is the type and picture and shadows, but the very image is the New Testament. We're the temple of God. We're the temple. The house of God was the inner sanctuary. Christ is the son of his own house. Whose house are we? It was God's house, because Jesus came down as the I Am God and sat down upon the Ark of the Covenant, which was the throne of God. When you run into the throne of God in Revelation, it's talking about this, but that's our hearts now. The law is written on tables of stone and kept inside the Ark of the Covenant. Now it's written on fleshy tables of our hearts. That shouldn't be that hard. And that was this kingdom of God. Who is their king? Christ. Where does he live now? In us. Christ in you, the hope of glory. The kingdom of God is in you. Luke 17, 20 and 21. It's in us. You can match up everything over here with everything over here. Go over here to, well, let's read the rest of this. The city of the living God. So, Mount Zion now. Mount Zion. Or Zion. Equals heavenly Jerusalem, doesn't it? I said it last week, and I've said it a lot of weeks. Literal Jerusalem, in the book, in the 11th chapter of Revelation, is called Sodom and Egypt, even where our Lord was crucified. Why would he equate heavenly Jerusalem with literal Jerusalem? He wouldn't. Heaven and Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn. The church is equal to heavenly Jerusalem, and that's equal to Mount Zion. So when you find God's going to bring his people to Mount Zion, who shall inherit God's holy hill? In the 15th chapter of Psalms. Those that are walking uprightly. They don't hurt people. They swear, and they will not change from the truth. They'll say, this is the truth, and you can like it or not like it. They're back over here, and he says, to the church which are written in heaven. The heavens was the ruling class. Now go back over here to Revelation 20. Always think in the New Testament, Jerusalem is the church. In fact, in Galatians, the 4th chapter, the Bible says Jerusalem is our mother. And our mother, a mother was an instructor. Now, go back over here to Revelation 20, 21. And I saw new heaven and new earth. That was prophesied in the 65th chapter of Isaiah, wasn't it? And it was concerning God rejecting literal Jerusalem, literal Israel, and accepting Gentile church, spiritual Israel, spiritual Jerusalem, spiritual Mount Zion. Anytime you see that there's going to be a Mount Zion that's going to believe God, it's talking about the church. Now, Chapter 21, verse 1, I saw a new heaven and new earth. See, that's not talking about there's going to be this great big wonderful new earth and a great big wonderful new heaven. I don't know what's going to be hereafter. I know I'm going to be with the Lord. And I'm not trying to figure that out. I'm trying to understand this. New heaven and new earth, for the first heaven, literal Israel, and the first earth, those that were ruled by literal Israel, were passed away, and there was no more sea. That's because this heavenly Jerusalem that we're in doesn't have ships in a sea. This Jerusalem is all spiritual. I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem. What's that talking about? Not talking about what these preachers and so-called doctors of theology. We've already understood New Jerusalem has to do with the church. Watch what it says. New Jerusalem, or the church, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. What is the bride of Christ? Is that the church? This is a picture of the overall new birth of the church from one end of the Bible to the other. This is a picture of new birth coming down from God out of heaven as a bride. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is dwelling with men. What's that talking about? Tabernacle, skews. It comes to the word skene, S-K-E-N-E, and it means a wife that is useful to her husband. This is the church, and a tabernacle is a mobile temple, and that's what we are as we dwell upon the earth. Then he says, I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. That's what he told Israel in the Old Testament. We are God's people in the earth, and we have the king living in us, and we are the kingdom of God. And we're ruling over the earth with a scepter of righteousness with the word of God. The Word of God rules people. It makes them upset. It makes them pull away from you. You try to talk to them about truth. They'll even call themselves Christians. And you start talking to them about Christmas or baptism is blood, not water. And you talk to them about they weren't eating crackers and drinking grape juice. They were eating the last Passover. And now the Passover is spiritual. Got the Passover lamb, which is Jesus mentioned in the 5th chapter of 1 Corinthians. You got the third cup of the Passover mentioned in 1 Corinthians 10:17. The cup of blessing which we bless is not the communion of the blood of Christ, and that was the third cup of the Passover. The title of it was cup of blessing. Well, that's in the 16th verse. 17th verse of 1 Corinthians 10 says, we, being many, are one bread and one body. We're the bread. That's us. Because Christ is in us. Everything you read through the Bible is going to be about Israel. Then he says, God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death. There's not any death as far as we're concerned. It matters not about a man who can destroy the body, but him that can destroy both soul and body in hell. Neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain in the church. For the former things are passed away, talking about literal Israel. They're being taken into captivity. They're being abused and beaten all these years. And he that sat upon the throne, the Ark of the Covenant. All through this book, you're going to find the throne mentioned. That the throne of God was where he would come down out of the Shekinah glory cloud. And the God of the Old Testament was the I Am God. And Jesus said, that's me. Before Abraham was, I am. And he come down and sat down right there and dwelt between the cherubim. The word dwelt means to build a house. He was married to Israel. That was Jesus. People can't find these. They can't find the shadow and the very image. If you get into study of the shadows and the very image, everything in the Old Testament equals New Testament. That's why these guys, you got some people, why do you have so many denominations? Because they do not study the shadows and the images. Now let's read on. He that sat upon the throne, upon the Ark of the Covenant, he sits upon our hearts. Christ dwelleth not in temples made with hands. He dwells in this temple. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Colossians 1:27, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Luke 17:20-21, the temple of God is, the kingdom of God is in you. You are the temple of God. How do people miss all this spiritual understanding? Let's read on. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. I am making the kingdom of God new. Instead of Old Testament Israel, it's going to be a spiritual kingdom. And he said unto, it really gets me, people can't see some of this. How much time do I have, Mike?
7 minutes.
How much?
Seven.
I don't have time to finish this. I'll come back. He said unto me, Write these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and I will give unto them that is athirst the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all spiritual things. Overcometh is just the verb form of victory. Overcometh, N-I-K-A-O. The word victory is N-I-K-E. Nike, probably get the word Nike from that. If you buy Nike tennis shoes, you can outrun everybody. You can have the victory. But faith is the victory that overcomes the world. There in 1 John the 5th chapter, he's talking about faith here. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Takes you over there to Romans 8:14. Those that are obedient to the God, they are sons of God. But the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And we have no part in the second death according to the 20th chapter. Or the second separation. Now, look here what he says in verse 9. This is very interesting. There came unto me one of the seven angels of the seven churches. If the seven angels were here, they try to come up and say, the rapture happens there in the third chapter, about the 10th verse, where God delivers from the hour of temptation. They say, that's the rapture. Oh, baloney. If the candlesticks are here, or if the Holy Spirit is here inside the candlesticks, what's the Holy Spirit do? Wandering around in the air, hovering around, kind of going, let me see if I can find some place to inhabit. The candlesticks, the whole purpose of the angels is the candlesticks. Because the angels are the picture of the Holy Spirit or the truth. So he says, one of the seven angels came, full of seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, and notice what he says, come hither, I will show thee the bride that came down from heaven in the first part of this chapter. I'll show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. That has to be the church, doesn't it? And watch what he shows him, the next verse. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, the church. If he's showing him the bride, he's showing him the church, isn't he? The holy Jerusalem descending out of heaven from God. I forgot to give you a verse over here in Revelation, the third chapter. Let me go back over there. And he's talking to, third chapter, verse, he's talking here to the church of Philadelphia. Verse 12. Him that overcometh, Nikao, he has faith, and faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Make I will make a pillar. Now, he's not going to make us out of concrete or marble, is he? No. A pillar in the temple of my God, and we are the temple of God. And he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven. Same words over here in the 20th chapter, right? Heavenly Jerusalem coming down out of from God out of heaven. That's the church. That's not some big city that looks like a cube. Now let's read on here. Descending out of heaven, having the glory of God. What is the glory of God? According to Psalms, the 19th chapter and the first chapter of Hebrews. The glory of God is Jesus. Having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like jasper stone, clear as crystal. Now, I went through these stones, and I believe the 12 stones that the city's built on is just the same 12 stones that was in the breastplate of the high priest over there in Exodus. But I want to show you something. It had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereupon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates, and on the west 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles. Look at Ephesians. Look at Ephesians, the second chapter. Now, have I finished studying Revelation? No, not on your life. And I'm going to see a lot more in it. But you have to compare it with everything else. Now, the foundation, the Bible speaks of the foundation in Ephesians. That's Colossians. I won't ever get it there. All right. Ephesians. In the second chapter, that's Philippians. I'll get to it here soon. All right. Ephesians, the second chapter. This will show you that we're spiritual Israel. Do I have any time?
No.
I'll go ahead and read this. And you are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. If Jesus is, that's in verse 20. If he's the chief cornerstone, we're not talking about a literal building. In whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God. He's going to live in us in the Spirit. Everything in Revelation is a spiritual picture of the church, heavenly Jerusalem, the church. I believe this is a picture of the new birth when you come to verse 1, new heaven, new earth. It's talking about all those Gentiles that are going to come into the kingdom. I'm out of time. I've got much more to say on the book of Revelation, but we're going to stop right here. I'll come back and fill in some places that I missed when able. I love when you get to the 22nd chapter. No, I'm not going to say it. I'll stop. Huh?
I've got all night. Keep teaching.
Well, I'm going to have to quit. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for truth. Lord, I don't know what to even ask anymore. You know what you want to do with this ministry. Open up doors, fight our battles, and seven all of us, Lord. Cause us to be sevened. Mature the church. Cause the people to be hungry. Make us aware of what's coming. We'll give you praise for all things. In Christ's name, amen. There's so much to this, I can't begin to get into it all. But I have found that the church is described throughout Revelation. Most people are looking for helicopters and smoke out of some pit where the nuclear explosion and just.
And a dragon, big red dragon breathing fire.
Yeah. Dragon, Dracon, means to fascinate.
Billy Graham.
Huh?
Billy Graham.
Well, he just a small part of it. He is a dragon.
I was going to ask you, how did the Gentile converts, when they came into truth, how did they grasp the Jewishness of Revelation and those teachings? I mean, were they being taught those things?
Well, God had to reveal it to them. They knew all the culture and the customs of the day they were in. It's like we know the customs. I know the customs and the culture of the 50s. I was a teenager. Hey, man, that's real cool. Daddy-o, I know all those customs. I know what they meant. They knew what things meant. They knew the culture. They knew the heavens, what that meant. They knew it was a ruling class. So when it speaks of the heavens or the throne of God, it's talking about the Ark of the Covenant, which is our hearts. The law is written on fleshy tables, our hearts are sprinkled. Bye, Milton. Let me go say bye to Milton. Milton? Milton, where are you going? Milton? Wait a minute. I love you. I love you. I love you, Sheldon.
Sheldon. Hey, we're going to the chop house. Meet us there.
Huh?
Meet us at chop house.
I'm not going to the chop house. I'm going home, lay down. I am tired after these two messages. But I love you and I like you too. You know? Are you behaving?
Sometimes I'm not. Sometimes I'm not.
Well, when you're young, you have a tendency.